Hello everyone, today we shall discuss about renal blood flow. Kidneys receive 22% of the total cardiac output. As we know that normally cardiac output is 5 liters per minute and 22% of it is received by kidneys. Now this renal blood flow serves very important functions like delivering oxygen, nutrients and hormones. Then mainly it delivers substrates for excretion in the urine. Indirectly it determines the GFR and it participates in the concentration and dilution of urine. Next. Now this is the graph showing that sodium reabsorption is directly proportional to oxygen consumption. On the x-axis we have sodium reabsorption and on the y-axis we have oxygen consumption. Now the whatever the amount of sodium is reabsorbed is directly proportional to oxygen consumption. So as the sodium reabsorption increases, the oxygen consumption increases. In the bottom it is shown a basal oxygen consumption, that is just for the basic metabolic needs of the kidney. Now this oxygen consumption is mainly supplied by renal blood flow. So whatever renal blood flow is there, that is mainly responsible mainly for sodium reabsorption, and along with sodium, there will be reabsorption of amino acids, glucose and other necessary metabolites. The peculiarities of the renal blood flow. Rate of renal blood flow under basal conditions is very high. As we had just discussed, 22% of the cardiac output or 1200 ml per minute. Now during exercise, blood shunts this excess of blood flow towards the exercising muscles. And this is mainly because of the increased sympathetic discharge. Now the renal oxygen consumption is also very high, approximately 6 ml per 100 gram. And as we had just discussed, that the oxygen consumption is directly proportional to renal blood flow. And this oxygen consumption is mainly responsible for the sodium reabsorption. Now the arteriovenous extraction of oxygen is relatively low. Now this is how the branches of the renal artery mainly occur. So from the heart we have aorta, then the descending aorta, abdominal aorta, which divides into renal artery. Now the renal artery will divide into segmental artery. Segmental artery divides into lobular artery. Lobular artery further divides into interlobar artery, which then divides into arcuate artery. Then we have interlobular artery. And from the interlobular artery, we have afferent arteriole, which will then divide into a tuft of capillaries known as glomerulus. And from it, we have efferent arteriole. Now, the efferent arteriole will give rise to peritubular capillaries in case of cortical nephrons and vasa recta in case of juxtamedullary or corticomedullary nephrons. Now, the venous system is exactly parallel to the arterial system. So now the peritubular capillaries will drain into interlobular vein and the interlobular vein will then drain into arcuate veins. Vasa recta directly drains into arcuate veins. Arcuate vein will further drain into interlobar vein, which then drain into renal vein, and renal vein drains into inferior vena cava and finally into heart. So this is the basic vascular supply of the kidney. Now the renal blood flow. So now the number one labeled here is the renal artery. So from the hilum of the kidney, we know that on the medial side of the kidney, we have a depression or a curve known as hilum of the kidney through which renal artery enters and renal vein and pelvis leave the kidney. Now the number one is renal artery. It then divides into segmental arteries which will supply the major calluses. Now the segmental arteries divide into interlobar artery for each pyramid, and it runs in between the two pyramids of the medulla. Now the interlobar artery at the base of the pyramid, it divides into arcuate artery, that is left arcuate artery and the right arcuate artery. So it will simply branch into two arcuate arteries. Now from these arcuate arteries, number 5 arising is the interlobular artery. Now these are the parallel running arteries, and from the interlobular artery we will have the afferent arteriole, then the glomerulus, and finally the efferent arteriole. So number 1 is renal artery, number 2 is segmental, 3rd is interlobar, which is running between the two medullary pyramids, then arcuate artery at the base of the pyramid, and from it we have the interlobular artery. Next. So this diagram shows the same thing, that renal artery is dividing into segmental arteries, then interlobar arteries at the major and minor calluses, which then divides into, which will then run between these medullary pyramids and divide into arcuate arteries at the base of pyramid, and which will then divide into interlobular arteries, which extend into the cortex. Now the peritubular capillaries empty into the vessels of the venous system. Just like I had told earlier, the venous system is exactly parallel to the arteriolar vessels, and there is progressive formation of interlobular vein, arcuate vein, interlobar vein, and renal vein, which then leaves the kidney along with renal pelvis or the ureter. Now, the main 2 points are that renal circulation is unique in because it has 2 capillary beds, the glomerular capillary bed and the peritubular capillary bed. So as we can see in the diagram on the right side, initially we have the glomerulus, which is formed from afferent arteriole, and then the arteriole which leaves the glomerulus is the efferent arteriole. And along the loops of Henle, we have the peritubular system. Now the glomerulus has a higher pressure, that is 60 mmHg, and it is responsible for rapid fluid filtration. So this high pressure is needed for the fluid to filter rapidly. Now the peritubular capillaries have a pressure of 13 mmHg. So pressure is less, so that more amount of reabsorption can occur. So mainly these are arranged in series, and the glomerulus capillaries and the peritubular capillary, and in between the two we have efferent arteriole, which are mainly here to regulate it, that is by adjusting its resistance. Next. So here it is shown on the right side that the plexus is formed between the arterial system and the venous system, and exactly parallel arrangement of the venous system is there. And on the left side, the diagram showing that interlobar artery running between the two medullary pyramids, and at the base of the pyramid, it is dividing into arcuate arteries, right and left arcuate artery, which is then ascending upwards, and as interlobular artery, which will then give rise to afferent arteriole and the formation of glomerulus. Now in this diagram, we can see that above part, that is the light shaded part, is the cortex. Then we have the darker area, that is outer medulla, and more darker area, that is the inner medulla. As we can see that lot of arterial branches and lot of arteries are there in the cortex. So the renal cortex has a blood supply of about 98%, and very little blood supply, that is 1-2% blood supply, is there in the renal medulla. And in the medulla, as we can see, mainly the loop of Henle is present in the medulla and the outer and inner medullary collecting duct. So here the blood supply is less. Now the reason for less blood flow in the medulla is to prevent the washout of medullary hypertonicity. As you will read in subsequent lectures, that medullary nephrons are mainly concerned with the concentration and dilution of urine. So it is very important to maintain medullary hypertonicity. So there is little flow in the medulla, and the minimum amount of flow is just to meet its metabolic requirements. Now the determinants of the renal blood flow. So renal blood flow is measured by Fick's principle, and as you must have read in hemodynamics, flow is directly proportional to change in pressure divided by resistance. So difference between renal arterial and renal venous pressure divided by R, that is the total vascular resistance. And the major sites of resistance in the kidney are afferent arteriole, efferent arteriole, and the interlobular artery. Now the measurement of renal blood flow is by electromagnetic flow meter or paraaminohippuric acid clearance, and indirectly by filtration fraction. Now what is filtration fraction? It is GFR divided by renal plasma flow. Next. Now the measurement of the renal plasma flow by paraaminohippuric acid. Now we inject the paraaminohippuric acid. Now this is mainly used because it is neither metabolized nor absorbed by the kidney after it is filtered, and it is almost completely filtered so that renal venous flow is minimal and can be neglected. So the clearance of the pH or the paraaminohippuric acid is used to measure the renal plasma flow. Now what is clearance? Clearance is the amount of plasma that is completely cleared of a substance in a unit time. That means whatever the plasma is flowing through the afferent arteriole, and when it filters through the glomerulus, then this plasma, when it contains a particular substance, so the total substance, the total plasma that will be cleared of that substance will give us the clearance of the substance. So here we mainly use paraaminohippuric acid to measure the blood flow because it is almost completely excreted by filtered by the kidney through a single pass. That is, when the blood flows through the glomerulus, in a single blood flow, majority of the pH will be filtered out and only minute amount will be passed in the renal vein. So this clearance of pH, which determines the renal plasma flow, is the urine concentration of the pH into urine flow rate, that is denoted by V dot, divided by plasma concentration of pH. Now here we are not considering the venous concentration. We are only talking about the arterial plasma concentration. This is because venous concentration is considered to be negligible. So this clearance of pH comes about 600 ml per minute. So renal plasma flow is about 600 ml per minute. Next. Now the effective renal plasma flow is given by the clearance of the pH. So what we discussed earlier, that clearance of pH or paraaminohippuric acid gives us renal plasma flow. It is actually effective renal plasma flow because of the total blood, about 10% of the blood flows to the non-parenchymal tissues of the kidney. So in this formula, since we had ignored this value, so it was effective renal plasma flow which we had obtained. through the clearance. And to obtain the true renal plasma flow, we will have to divide the effective renal plasma flow by 0.9, because we had ignored this 10% value. So actually the value obtained was 90% of what we had obtained. So true renal plasma flow will be effective renal plasma flow divided by 0.9. Now to calculate renal blood flow. Renal blood flow is renal plasma flow into 1 divided by 1 minus hematocrit. Now hematocrit is also known as PCV, and normally it is 45%. So if we divide the true renal plasma flow by 1 minus 0.45, that is renal plasma flow divided by 0.55, we will get the renal blood flow to be about 1200 ml per minute.